Tim, a lot of talk about China this morning as it relates to Apple, but Apple didn't entirely point to China as the whole issue. They also pointed to some developed markets and upgrade issues. I'm wondering, as you see these numbers and digest what Tim Cook said to our Josh Lipton, to what degree might the overall iPhone story be at risk here? And this idea I put forth a bit ago, that it's possible that Apple overextended itself with the iPhone X as far as pricing and kind of created the haves, many of whom have a 10-level device, and the have-nots who perhaps don't want to upgrade.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I think the two are related, and if I could just touch on China quickly. It's been weak for a few years there, and Apple did see some growth in 2017, and they are losing share this year, and it's been happening most of the year. So we think it is not just a macro issue. I do think there is some market share loss going on, and I think it relates to price elasticity of the product. There are a lot of alternatives in China and elsewhere that are cheaper. In addition to, I don't think it's really trade war related. We think it's just not a compelling product, and in China, that's one of the places that's really cutting edge for features on devices, and it's not working. When we look more broadly, yeah, I think it is price elasticity, and the product is stale. We haven't, since the 6 and the 6 Plus, we really haven't had a very successful cycle. Even the iPhone 10 was only modestly successful. So we think it's basically the weight of, you know, several years without a compelling innovation in the product.
Larry, Apple had been so consistent, just kind of rock solid as far as how it was able to deliver on numbers. Whether you're holding on, selling a little, buying, what is the data point that jumps out at you most out of this Apple miss?
Oh, I think it, interestingly, John, didn't come from Apple. It came from Tencent. And if you look at the Chinese market, the elephant in the room is that in China, the use of the smartphone is to play games. And during the fourth quarter, the government, because they were worried about youth going astray, basically stopped the release of new games. You get back to Apple with the problem of price elasticity. The Apple phone's over $1,000. The competitive phones are much less than that. If you are using the phone to play games, the Apple phone is disadvantaged. And if there are no new games, the phone is double disadvantaged. So as
a consequence, not even the Chinese economy, sentiment about Apple, you think it's got to do with gaming?
Oh, I think the gaming is probably in the neighborhood of 50% of the shortfall. And the problem is, John, this is not going to go away. The Chinese consumer is not going to change their behavior. And Tim said on the call that the App Store is going to have more apps coming out in China. When that happens, then I would expect the share to go up and Apple to be able to justify the premium price for its product. But right now, the Chinese market is, I think, going to be very difficult, and you have to take that into consideration when you look at the stock. But, you know, you can't break your neck falling out of the basement. And the stock's at 7x cash flow, and it's going to check off every metric if you're a value investor. High return on equity, high return on assets, high margin. It's the number one brand in the world.
Disclose, right, Larry? You're a shareholder of Apple. So are you a believer enough that you're buying on this dip of 9%?
Well, I think I think probably very shortly we'll add to the position. We haven't so far because I wanted to get my feelings out. I don't want to front run folks. But the value proposition here in the stock, John, if you believe in value investing, and most of the charts say the value investing is down in the basement anyway, well, with Apple, it just hit the sub-basement. So now you have this marvelous company that very rarely gets into the value universe. And you look at it, the services business in the United States and the retail business, this is probably one of the best consumer businesses I've ever seen. And investors are going to get a bonus in quarters to come because Tim's going to disclose what the margins are. And I think the margins are just going to be sensational. And the free cash...
Do the margins matter as much as services growth? And what if iPhone slowing actually ends up slowing down services? I'm still not clear on how the two are related. Well, if services growth kind of lags iPhone growth and then iPhone slowdown turns into a services slowdown or what?
I don't think it really matters here, John, because what's happening is You're at 7x cash flow, and you have a stock with a market value of $600 billion net of cash, and you have $50 billion of free cash flow, and you have a management that's been responsible in the board, which is a high-quality board, for allocating the free cash flow very efficiently. The return from buying the stock right now is 8%, plus you save 2% on the dividend, and the cash return from hoarding the stock and hoarding the free cash flow is nothing. So you have an enormous spread. It's very, very hard to get the stock down when you have a board that understands that and the math that's this compelling. At the end of the day, in this business, you go for the math and you try to leave your emotions at the post in the racetrack.